In this video, we're going to talk about the StreamLive HD Video Mixer. We're going to look at what it does and who it's for. Hi, I'm Aaron Parecki. I'm a huge fan of small portable video mixers, and that's why I was so excited to get my hands on this thing to try it out. I normally use these for recording live events in person, like conferences or meetups, but also to host live streams from my studio here. So let's take a look at this StreamLive HD Video Mixer and see exactly what it can do. Full disclosure, A10 sent this to me to review, but I do have to send it back when I'm done. I'm not being paid for this review. All these opinions are my own. They also don't get any input into what I say in this video. All right, so here we go. The first thing to keep in mind is that you will need an iPad to control this. It comes with a USB-C cable that you can use on the new iPad Pro. If you have one of the older Lightning iPads, then you'll need to get the camera adapter with the USB port. It does support a pretty wide range of iPads, but you should still check the list of supported iPads to make sure yours will work. Also note that this does not work with an Android or a computer or an iPhone. It specifically requires an iPad device. This little slot on top is meant to hold your iPad. Okay, let's start by talking about inputs and outputs. Input 1 supports an input resolution of 4K. It's also got this pass-through port to output that same signal. Now, it will downscale to 4K when it's streaming and recording, but it does mean that you can actually output it to a 4K monitor locally to see your full resolution on a screen in person. HDMI input 2 is split into A and B, and that's not something I've seen other switchers do, so we're going to look into that a little bit more later. As for outputs, this has not one, but two encoders built in, and that means you can actually stream to two platforms at the same time, like YouTube and Facebook, built in. It also means you can use one of the encoders instead for recording to disk, so you can stream and then record a backup copy locally. Recording to the USB drive will give you an H.264 MP4 recording. Of course, there's also this Ethernet jack to plug it into a network so that you can stream on the internet. There's another HDMI output here, which will give you the full program feed. You can either use that to just monitor what you're recording locally, or you could record to another backup copy using an external recorder. However, you can also use that to monitor any of your input sources in case you need to see what those look like without actually switching to them. Now let's talk about audio. There's a 1/4-inch microphone jack, and there's also a stereo pair of RCA jacks. Of course, all the HDMI inputs can also accept audio. One of the other really useful things this has is a headphone jack so you can actually monitor the audio coming out of this device. Okay, so that's it for inputs and outputs. Now you might be thinking, that's weird, this only has 3 HDMI inputs and also kind of 2 because of the way they're labeled. That seems pretty limiting, right? But that's where things get interesting. One of the unique things about this device is the way these buttons on the top work. You might notice there's 8 buttons on the top, but there are not 8 inputs. And that's because, unlike other switchers, this one is scene-based or layout-based rather than switching to inputs. So you actually go in and set up to 8 scenes, and then you switch to those scenes with these buttons. Those scenes can be a combination of inputs and graphics and overlays and picture-in-pictures, which is what we're going to look into next. All right, let's jump into the iPad app. This is where you'll set up each of the 8 scenes. Now, you're probably going to want one scene that is a full frame of each of your 2 cameras, and one that's a full frame of your computer slides. That's going to take up 3 slots. The way these scenes are built is you first choose a base layer, and then you can add text or other graphics on top. Your base layer can be either input 1, input 2, A or B, or a combination of the two, like picture-in-picture or side-by-side, or a flat background image. This dual view is where things get really interesting. In this mode, you can position, resize, and crop any of the HDMI inputs, and you can layer that on top of a background image. So that means you can actually get the side-by-side view that I always want in conference videos, where you've got the conference branding in the background, and then a scaled-down view of the slides next to a cropped view of the presenter. That's a lot better than picture-in-picture, because then you know that your video of the person's not actually going to be blocking any of their slides. This is super cool because it usually takes a lot more gear or more expensive gear to get something like this in a dedicated hardware device. Okay, so input 2 is this sort of weird one. On the back, input 2 has 2 HDMI ports labeled A and B. The way this works is that basically input 2 can show video from either of the 2 feeds, but not both together. So you can use either A or B in a scene when you're building it, you just can't put them both in the scene at the same time. You also can't crossfade between a scene that includes an input from A as well as from B. You have to go through a static image or fade to input 1. But that's why I feel like this is really meant for presentations, where you've got a computer feed coming in on input 1, that's going to be the person's slides, and then you've got a close-up view on A and a wide-angle view on B. Because that means you can cut between a view of their slides, a close-up view, the split-screen view, and then a wide angle view. And you've got that all within this device that you can switch to from these scene buttons on the top. Okay, let's look at the other tabs in the iPad app, starting with the audio tab. The audio tab is where you can set up which audio sources you want to be part of your program audio. You can choose to bring in audio from your HDMI sources or from your analog jacks on the back. The two HDMI inputs can also be set to auto follow video or AFV, and that means they will automatically turn on when that shot is in the scene. Most of what I would use this for would be running a single audio feed into the analog jack on the back and not dealing with the HDMI audio at all. All right, the settings tab is where you configure the streaming and recording settings. Like I mentioned before, this has two encoders, which means you can either stream to two locations or stream to one and record to the USB drive on the other. So this is where you can put in your RTMP URL and stream key and choose your encoding settings. You can choose a couple of these presets or drag the slider and choose your bitrate manually. One of the nice things here is that you can actually set a global audio delay. So in case your HDMI feeds are delayed out of the camera, you can make sure to delay the audio so that they match up. It is a global audio delay, it's not set per input, so it's not quite as flexible as you might want, but it is still better than nothing. Let's do a quick test of looking at what the recorded output looks like from this device. I'm going to record a quick segment to a USB drive as well as stream a copy to YouTube and pull those down and splice those into the video here. What you're seeing now is the recorded feed to the USB drive. This is recorded again at the same quality that it is streaming at, in this case, 6 megabits a second. And now what you're seeing is the copy that YouTube has. I downloaded this video from YouTube and that's what you're seeing now. It should look pretty much the same as what's recorded to disk, except for the fact that YouTube has already now post-processed the video. There is only one go live button, which both starts recording and streaming, and you don't get to control those separately, so whatever is streaming is also being recorded. I can see an indication on the iPad here telling me that it is in fact streaming at 6 megabits. It looks like it's keeping the bitrate up to date. And of course, I can crossfade between any scenes I've set up. In this case, I will crossfade to myself, scaled down, put in a little corner on top of my splash screen. Looking at how these devices encode crossfades is a good test because that can often push the limits of what the encoder can do at that bitrate. All right, so that's enough about the features. Let's talk about what I like and dislike about this, starting with what I am not a huge fan of. This T-bar fader, honestly, is pretty useless. It's basically impossible to use it to get a smooth crossfade. It kind of skips around. But honestly, I've just never really been a fan of these things. I much prefer either doing a hard cut or a really fast transition between two scenes. And that's much better done automatically by the device itself. The good news is, this device can do both of those with these buttons on the front, cut and auto. But it does mean that I'm just never gonna use this T-bar and it is kind of taking up extra space. One of the other things to keep in mind is that you will need an iPad to operate this. Now, the good news is, once things are set up, you actually don't need the iPad to actually run it because you've got the scene switchers and the streaming button on the device itself. But in order to set it up the first time, you will need that iPad to configure your scenes and build the settings into the device. So that basically just means that it will cost you a little bit extra on top of the cost of the device to actually start using it in productions. But the good news is you can use one of the cheaper $300 iPads just fine. One of the other downsides is that it is a little bit limiting having just the three HDMI inputs. The only other real downside is the size. Now, it's not huge, but it's also not tiny. It's a smaller footprint than most laptops, but it is pretty thick. And with this T-bar on the top, that adds quite a bit of height and makes it not really packable into a backpack easily. If they removed the T-bar, that would save a lot on the height, and I could honestly do without the little kickstand in the back, or at least have that be removable if I did want to be more flat and able to be packed down better. But the build quality is solid. It feels very sturdy. Okay, now onto the things that make it unique, especially at this price point. Now it does cost somewhere between $1,000 to $1,200, depending on where you get it, but that actually is a pretty good value for what's packed into this device. Doing this much stuff with other devices will require a lot of extra components, either a full computer or additional hardware to bring in graphics or do scaling in ways that other devices don't have built in. This 8-button scene switcher is extremely powerful, and that's one of the things that's unique about this device. This lets you do things like set up scenes, set up picture in picture, multiple pictures in pictures, background graphics, overlays, and you get to switch to them as if they were camera angles. On other devices, you pretty much always need to have some sort of additional control surface in order to do something similar. Something like the Stream Deck, for example, which gives you buttons to control things in your computer or other devices. And that's great, but it's really nice that it's just all built into this one. Probably my favorite feature about this device, though, is that you can do side-by-side scaled views from two of the inputs. That means you can get a shrunk-down version of the presenter's slides next to a shrunk-down version of their video, and you don't end up having to cover up the presenter's slides with a picture-in-picture view like you do on most other switchers. And because you can load in images, you can even have background graphics behind the whole thing. I have been searching for a way to do this kind of layout for a long time, and I have not found anything that costs less than $3,000 so far. So the fact that this device can do this is just incredible. Overall, I would say this is probably a little bit easier to get started with compared to something that requires desktop software. The nice thing is you can use this iPad app, which very quickly lets you go in and build your scenes with just this touch interface. So thanks again to A10 for sending this over for us to look at. I had a great time checking it out and playing around with it. If you have questions about this device or streaming in general, join me over at the livevideotech.today forums. We are growing a great community of people interested in video production and live streaming. Thanks for watching, and please give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. If you do want to buy one of these, please use the affiliate link in the description below. It doesn't cost you anything, and it really does help out this channel and make it so I can make more videos like this. Thanks so much, and I will see you in the next one.